Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sisters in the Wilderness, The Challenge of Womanist God Talk, by Delores S. Williams, Foreword by Katie G. Cannon, narrated by Machelle Williams. Foreword to the 20th Anniversary Edition. 20 years ago, in 1993, when Delores S. Williams published her book, Sisters in the Wilderness, The Challenge of Womanist God Talk, few African-American women who self-identify as womanist theologians were aware of the centrality of this text in relation to the metamorphosis taking place both within and around Black women's existential context. That was a year when African-American women ripped historical seams and changed traditional patterns, a fact that can now be seen not only with the hindsight of religious scholars looking back over two decades of theological discourse, but also from diverse perspectives across our multi-stranded, thickly textured body politic. For instance, in 1993, some of us celebrated Thelma D. Adair, who, as the co-chairperson of the U.S. Committee on the Ecumenical Decade of Churches in Solidarity with Women, served as one of the planners and participants in the Reimagining Conference held in Minneapolis. Evelyn Brooks Higginbotham, who published her historical analysis of the social, political, and ethical contributions of women in the African American Baptist Church in Righteous Discontent, the women's movement in the Black Baptist Church, 1880 through 1920, and Toni Morrison, who won the Nobel Prize in Literature for her novel, Beloved. Others may appreciate how in 1993, Maya Angelou read her poem On the Pulse of Mourning at the inauguration of the 42nd President of the United States. Mary Frances Berry, a founding member of the Free South Africa Movement, was appointed the first African-American woman to chair the Civil Rights Commission. Eleanor Holmes Norton, who serves the District of Columbia as delegate to the U.S. House of Representatives and who continues to fight for D.C. statehood on behalf of its residents, gained the right to vote in the House of Representatives, and Carol Mosley Braun became the first African-American woman on the Senate Finance Committee. Her maiden speech to the Senate, delivered January 26, 1993, was a eulogy to Supreme Court Justice Thurgood Marshall. And still again, a few among us may recall the mean-spirited character assaults against Black women in 1993, when Lonnie Guinier, a first-rate professor, one of this nation's leading legal scholars and civil rights advocates, was caricatured by a New York Post columnist as a quota queen. And in the same time frame, Joycelyn Elders, the first African-American woman to hold the position of U.S. Surgeon General, faced controversy over her opinions on issues such as sex education, the legalization of narcotics, procreative choice, and conservatives quickly dubbed her the Condom Queen. Some of us may remember that 1993 brought us a surprising gift from the world of hip-hop. Queen Latifah issued Black Rain, her most popular album, featuring her single, UNITY, which won a Grammy Award for Best Solo Rap Performance. With confidence, competence, and conviction, Delores Williams claimed her place among this cloud of progressive soul sisters in 1993 by publishing this groundbreaking book, Sisters in the Wilderness. The contextual antecedents for this theological accomplishment are the living spaces carved out by womanist theologians who were in sync with the liberation wisdom of 1985. At that time, Cheryl Townsend Gilkes, as the first national convener of the Womanist Approach to Religion and Society group, presented African-American women who were members of the AARSBL with a laudable goal: the crafting of programmatic strategies that would ensure lasting participation in bringing our education, talents, and imagination to bear in the wider world. Sean M. Copeland sums up the womanist theological agenda as differentiating the experiences, such as religious, personal, cultural, social, psychological, and biological, of African-American women in the hermeneutical circle of theological inquiry and research, reflection, and judgment. Before 1993, two womanist monographs were published, My Black Womanist Ethics and Jacqueline Grant's White Women's Christ, Black Women's Jesus, Feminist Christology and Womanist Response. Since the publication of Sisters in the Wilderness in 1993, womanists have published more than 24 books documenting the claim that rigorous inquiry and open communication of, by, and for Black women are essential as we rethink the content and method of theology, ethics, and biblical exegesis. Still, critics from within the academy and outside it may ask, what is the significance of the wilderness metaphor to people who teach and preach in a 21st century globalized world, a world that moves at breakneck speed with interlocking economies, cultures, government, policies, military affairs, and political movements? In the context of religious scholarship, Williams' answer is clear. Using the cautionary tale of Hagar, the Egyptian woman in the book of Genesis, chapter 16, the handmaid of Sarah, who is cast out into the wilderness, Williams exposes realistic details of the painful limits set against Black existence in U.S. society. The heart of Williams' thesis acknowledges the joys and sorrows, ups and downs, gains and losses of Black women searching for meaning in an unjust world. With this book, Williams launched an interdisciplinary, intertextual womanist conversation. She examined Hagar's legacies and myths via biblical exegesis and literary criticism, and artfully wove together the threads of these two interpretive tools through nuanced African-American cultural history. In order to bring us to the contemporary understanding of what it means to refer to and identify African Americans as Aunt Hagar's children, women, men, and children who feel ostracized, alienated, and cast out into modern-day deserts. In other words, stories about our identity as Aunt Hagar's children exemplify how truth claims about the bygone days of slavery are linked to our God consciousness and survivalist intentions as descendants of freed people living in these contemporary times. Writing metaphorically about the biblical understanding of wilderness, Williams responds to the question raised by critics in this way. Hagar's experience in the wilderness of Beersheba serves as a symbolic counterpart to the living reality of numerous African-American women and children who live in conditions of vast, bewildering peril here and now. Pulling no punches, Delores Williams elaborates in graphic detail on the exorbitant price women in the African diaspora pay with our embodied social selves when forced into exploitative motherhood and coercive surrogacy. Notably, for those of us who have been reading and teaching Sisters in the Wilderness since 1993, and who, as theological educators, will continue to use this book as a required text for decades to come, we accept Williams' invitation to join her in wrestling with Hagar's God, a God who sees and hears. She contends that theologians need to think seriously about the real-life consequences of redemptive suffering, God talk that equates the acceptance of pain, misery, and abuse as the way for true believers to live as authentic Christian disciples. Those who spew such false teaching and warped preaching must cease and desist. This 20th anniversary edition of Sisters in the Wilderness, The Challenge of Womanist God Talk, is a key theological source for womanist scholarship far beyond the traditional parameters of the American Academy of Religion and Society of Biblical Literature. With each passing year, Black women theologians continue to dispel the notion of patriarchal, androcentric, value-free objectivity by publishing our radically relativized, contextualized truth. We devote a great deal of time to interdisciplinary, cross-cultural, non-dualistic divides in our writing and teaching. As progressively thinking African-American women, we are mindful of the various ways that our very presence creates cognitive dissonance in customary communities of power. Thus, Sisters in the Wilderness is a revealing window that encourages us to look to the margins rather than the central spaces for the divine presence in women's real-world liberation struggles. By wrapping our minds around the complexities embedded in wilderness living, womanists and all others who cast their lot with us appreciate the way Williams brings into sharp focus the need for us to eradicate race, sex, class, and gender oppression, as well as Eurocentric imperialistic thinking embedded in the faith claims of church and society. Katie G. Cannon. Preface. I have come to believe that theologians, in their attempt to talk to and about religious communities, ought to give listeners some sense of their autobiographies. This can help an audience discern what leads the theologian to do the kind of theology she does. What has been the character of her faith journey? What lessons has this journey taught? What kind of faith inspires her to continue writing and rewriting, living and reliving theology in a highly secular, white and black world, paying little or no attention to what the theologians are saying? These questions posed within the context of my life history remind me of a form of community sharing in the Black church called testifying. Many times as a little girl, I sat in the church pew with my mother or grandmother and heard the Black believers, mostly women, testify about how far they had come by faith. They expressed their belief that God was involved in their history, that God helped them make a way out of no way. As they shared their trials, tribulations, and blessings, they asked the other communicants to pray for them. Their testimonies suggested they believed their lives were about more than white people's oppression of Black people. Now, years later, after my participation in the civil rights movement of the 1960s, after the births of my four children, after my college training, late seminary education, PhD studies, after the sudden death of my husband and my resulting single parent status, I find myself testifying. Faith, hard won, has taught me how to value the gains, losses, standoffs, and victories in my life. Many times the painful moments would not have been healed were it not for the road I traveled to faith, learning to trust the righteousness of God in spite of trouble and injustice, learning to trust women of many colors, regardless of sexism, racism, classism, and homophobia in our society. Learning to believe in the sanctuary power of family, defined in many ways in addition to nuclear. Discovering love in a variety of forms that heal, but also believing serious political action is absolutely necessary for justice to prevail in the world of my four Black children and other mothers' children. Faith has taught me to see the miraculous in everyday life, the miracle of ordinary Black women resisting and rising above evil forces in society, where forces work to destroy and subvert the creative power and energy my mother and grandmother taught me God gave Black women. Ordinary Black women, doing what they always do, holding the family and church together, working for the white folks or teaching school, enduring whatever they must so their children can reach for the stars, keeping hope alive in the family and community when money is scarce and white folks get mean and ugly. I discovered that this miraculous resisting and rising above has for generations been many Black women's contribution of faith, love, and hope to the Black family, to the church, and to the Black community in North America. Growing up in an African-American community in the urban South in the late 40s and 50s, I learned early to recognize the forces bent on conquering Black women's power to resist and rise above obstacles. There were some white people's intentions of ending the lives of Black women's children and demeaning Black women. Most children in my neighborhood knew the lore about the lynching of the Black man by white people on the lawn of the white hotel around the corner where white people lived. Many children knew a white man raped a Black woman and nearly killed her when she resisted. Black people had no legal recourse in either case. There were also some Black men's intentions of conquering Black women's power of resisting and rising above trouble. I remember hearing the blood-curdling screams of the woman in the house next to ours when her husband beat her for acting uppity, showing off her education, he said. She had been a schoolteacher. She packed her clothes, took her child, and went to her mama's house. She never returned to her husband. I remember the man living in an alley house at the rear of my grandmother's property. One night, when I was 10 years old, I saw him beat his wife unmercifully. She had hidden her day work money and would not give it to him. She left the next day and never came back. Physical violence done to Black women was matched by emotional and psychological pressure put upon them. School principals and preachers also tried to put impediments in Black women's way of resisting and rising above oppression. During the days of segregation in my native land of Kentucky, when Black males were in charge of selecting the Black females to fill teaching positions and were in charge of administering procedures to make divorced Black fathers pay child support, many of these males in charge tried to put the distribution of jobs and services to women on the basis of whether the women would have illicit affairs with them. Racism and male supremacy in the courts, on the school boards, and in the social service offices gave Black women no legal recourse. Too often, some of the preachers, to whom Black women turned for support, were as involved in propositioning Black women as were the other males. Nobody in the community did anything to stop this oppression of Black women. But in spite of antagonisms, ordinary spiritual Black women continued their struggle to resist and rise above the forces seeking to destroy their lives and spirits. More often than not, they accounted for their perseverance on the basis of their faith in God, who helped them make a way out of no way. The courage and perseverance of these everyday Black women shaped a model of faith and social behavior passed down to generations of women in the community and church. These ordinary women celebrated their lives in the social sense of church basket meetings, family reunions, children's graduations, their own graduations, community organization, children's successes, and church festivals in which they invested great care and preparation. In the midst of testifying about my own faith and marveling at the faith and courage of female progenitors, I reflect upon what it means to take seriously, as a primary theological source, the faith, thought, and life struggle of African American women. I am in the throes of what the ancient African theologian Augustine and the European theologian Anselm termed faith-seeking understanding. By understanding, I mean exploring faith so that I provide theological responses to issues confronting African American women and the Black community trying to survive in today's world. Faith-seeking understanding, from an oppressed Black female's perspective, means affirming the necessity of political and spiritual works, affirming these for the salvation of oneself and for the salvation of the Black family, of the homeless, of the destitute, of the young Black people lost in the drug culture in North America. Yet my female faith-seeking understanding asks questions. Given what looks like genocidal impulses in American culture directed toward Black people, male and female, what kind of works can stem from Black women's belief in a God who helps them make a way out of no way? How do I shape a theology that is at once committed to Black women's issues and life struggles and simultaneously addresses the Black community's historic struggle to survive and develop a positive, productive quality of life in the face of death? How do I design theological language and devise theological methods that not only speak in the academy, but also speak to African American women and the African American community in a language they can understand? How does my Black female theological voice join the chorus of non-Black women's voices and male voices in theology without compromising Black women's faith? How do we Black female theologians speak with all our strength when some white female and some Black male scholars work together to crowd out our voices or take control of our words? I realize my theological preoccupation with faith-seeking understanding cannot romanticize Black women's Christian faith. I cannot ignore how this faith has also been shaped by a process in Black and white communities that I recognize as colonization of female mind and culture. Nor can I ignore the fact that the African-American denominational churches, in their patriarchally and androcentrically biased liturgy and leadership, have been primary agents of this mind-culture colonization with regard to Black women. Yet the churches have also been psychosocial places where Black women could find some relief from the terrible burdens in their lives. Whether these burdens came from low self-esteem, from negative experience in love relations, from early deaths in the family, from loss of children to street and drug culture, or from white racism and economic oppression. The African American denominational churches told Black women they were somebody in a society that hated their race and spurned their womanhood. However, there is no doubt in my mind that some male preachers take advantage of the great emotional needs some Black women bring to the churches. Historically, however, the African American denominational churches have also been places where Black women, aside from venting their pain in emotional response, have come for decidedly theological reasons. They love God and the Spirit, and they come to church to celebrate the great work of the Spirit that brings and sustains whatever is positive in their lives. Hence, the shouting and rhythm in churches are part of Black women's faith statement, celebrating and giving thanks to God and the Spirit for working in their hearts and lives. This means, then, that the African-American denominational churches function like two-edged swords. They sustain Black women emotionally and provide theological space for Black women's faith expressions, but they suppress and help to make invisible Black women's thought and culture. Through their uncritical use of the Bible and through their patriarchal theology, many of the African-American denominational churches prohibit Black women from asking many critical questions about women's oppression and about the support and reinforcement of that oppression by the Bible and by the Christian church in all its male-dominated forms. Today, a theological corrective is developing that has considerable potential for bringing Black women's experience into theology so that Black women will see the need to transform the sexist character of their churches and their theology. The corrective, emerging among Black female theologians, ethicists, biblical scholars, ministers, and laywomen, is called womanist theology. This theology is beginning to provide real insight for my concern with faith-seeking understanding. As I see it, womanist theology is a prophetic voice reminding African-American denominational churches of their mission to seek justice and voice for all their people, of which Black women are the overwhelming majority in their congregations. Yet this prophetic voice is concerned about the well-being of the entire African-American community, female and male, adults and children. A little more than 10 years old, womanist theology emerged from what many of us saw as characteristic of Black women's experiences of relation, loss, gain, faith, hope, celebration, and defiance. While its aim is discourse and work with Black women in the churches, it also brings Black women's experience into the discourse of all Christian theology, from which it has previously been excluded. Womanist theology attempts to help Black women see, affirm, and have confidence in the importance of their experience and faith for determining the character of the Christian religion in the African-American community. Womanist theology challenges all oppressive forces impeding Black women's struggle for survival and for the development of a positive, productive quality of life conducive to women's and the family's freedom and well-being. Womanist theology opposes all oppression based on race, sex, class, sexual preference, physical disability, and caste. Like Black male liberation theology, womanist theology assumes the necessity of responsible freedom for all human beings. But womanist theology especially concerns itself with the faith, survival, and freedom struggle of African American women. Thus, womanist theology identifies and critiques black male oppression of black females, while it also critiques white racism that oppresses all African Americans, female and male. Like white feminist theology, womanist theology affirms the full humanity of women. But womanist theology also critiques white feminist participation in the perpetuation of white supremacy, which continues to dehumanize black women. Yet womanist theology is organically related to black male liberation theology and feminist theology in its various expressions, including African women's, Mujerista, Jewish, and Asian women's theology. Womanist theology, however, also branches off in its own direction, introducing new issues and constructing new analytical categories needed to interpret simultaneously black women's and the black community's experience in the context of theology. Nonetheless, womanist theology is usually non-separatist and dialogical. It welcomes discourse with a variety of theological voices, liberation, white feminist, Mujerista, Jewish, Asian, African, classical and contemporary mainstream, as well as non-feminist, non-womanist female voices. Womanist theology considers one of its primary tasks to dialogue with the church and with other disciplines. Given all the testimony, observations, descriptions, and questions raised, my task at this point is to tell the listener how I, a womanist theologian, come to do the God talk in this book. The following introduction is a proper place to begin, but first I must express my gratitude to people who helped along the way. Tom Driver, Beverly Harrison, Carter Hayward, Cheryl Townsend Gilks, Susan Thistlewaite, Anne Elliott, Joanne Terrell, the late Norman Wilkerson, and James Cohn read very early versions of this manuscript. Colleen Christula and my daughter, Rita A. Say, are due special thanks for their painstaking preparation of some of the earlier manuscripts. Yelini Senathirija provided immeasurable support as she put portions of the final version of this book on the computer. Betty Bolden is due more appreciation than I can ever give. Her assistance to me in the Burke Library at Union Theological Seminary was invaluable. I can never forget her faith in my work and her encouragement when all my simultaneous roles as mother, wife, student, poet, scholar, teacher weighed most heavily upon me. I also am greatly appreciative of Beverly Harrison, a true friend, who often provided so much comfort as I dealt with and tried to work through the stress of multi-role demands. Seth Kasten and Drew Cottle, research librarians at Union's Burke Library, helped me work through research problems. I am grateful to both of them. I thank my children, Rita, Celeste, Stephen, and Leslie, for the advice they have given me over the years to keep truckin', Mama. Also, my late husband, Robert C. Williams, is appreciated for the patience and encouragement he gave as I plowed through transformations of faith, spirit, and consciousness. And my mother, Gladys Carter, must be thanked for the great model of courage and perseverance she has been for her children. She, an African-American churchwoman, has always been there for us as a mighty pleasant help in time of trouble. My very last words of preface are these. I pray this book will also speak in a meaningful way to those African-American women who struggle by faith to bring dignity, hope, spiritual sustenance, economic well-being, and educational advancement to the everyday lives of Black people and to the African-American churches. But my hope is that these Black women, in all their giving, take Alice Walker's advice seriously and remember to love themselves regardless. Delores S. Williams. Introduction. Where would I begin in order to construct Christian theology, or God talk, from the point of view of African-American women? I pondered this question for over a year. Then one day, my professor responded to my complaint about the absence of Black women's experience from all Christian theology, Black liberation and feminist theologies included. He suggested that my anxiety might lessen if my exploration of African American cultural sources was consciously informed by the statement, "I am a Black woman." He was right. I had not realized before that I read African American sources from a Black male perspective. I assumed Black women were included. I had not noticed that what the sources presented as Black experience was really Black male experience. At that time, the mid-70s, not many Black women's writings were available. The Schomburg series of 19th-century Black women's writings, edited by Henry Louis Gates, Jr., had not appeared. Neither had the series Black Women in United States History, edited by Darlene Clark Hine. Nevertheless, when I began reading available Black female and Black male sources with my female identity fixed firmly in my consciousness, I made a startling discovery. I discovered that even though Black liberation theologians used biblical paradigms supporting an androcentric bias in their theological statements, the African American community had used the Bible quite differently. For over 100 years, the community had appropriated the Bible in such a way that Black women's experience figured just as eminently as Black men's in the community's memory, in its self-understanding, and in its understanding of God's relation to its life. As I read deeper in Black American sources from my female perspective, I began to see that it was possible to identify at least two traditions of African American biblical appropriation that were useful for the construction of Black theology in North America. One of these traditions of biblical appropriation emphasized liberation of the oppressed and showed God relating to men in the liberation struggles. In some African American spiritual songs, in slave narratives and in sermons by Black preachers, reference was made to biblical stories and personalities who were involved in liberation struggle. Moses, Jesus/God, Paul and Silas delivered from jail, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego delivered from the fiery furnace, and "My God delivered Daniel and why not every man?" All of these references appeared in the deposits of African American culture. Black male theologians had reflected upon these sources and also had been inspired by the liberation emphasis in the 1960s Black cultural and political revolution. So they produced Black liberation theology. Their validating biblical paradigm in the Hebrew Testament was the Exodus event, when God delivered the oppressed Hebrew slaves from their oppressors in Egypt. Their Christian Testament paradigm was Luke chapter 4, when Jesus described his mission and ministry in terms of liberation. Their normative claim for biblical interpretation was God the liberator of the poor and oppressed. I reasoned that it is possible, then, to name this tradition the liberation tradition of African American biblical appropriation. My discovery of the second tradition of African American biblical appropriation excited me greatly. This tradition emphasized female activity and de-emphasized male authority. It lifted up from the Bible the story of a female slave of African descent who was forced to be a surrogate mother, reproducing a child by her slave master because the slave master's wife was barren. For more than 100 years, Hagar, the African slave of the Hebrew woman Sarah, has appeared in the deposits of African American culture. Sculptors, writers, poets, scholars, preachers, and just plain folks have passed along the biblical figure Hagar to generation after generation of Black folks. As I encountered Hagar again and again in African American sources, I reread her story in the Hebrew Testament and Paul's reference to her in the Christian Testament. I slowly realized there were striking similarities between Hagar's story and the story of African American women. Hagar's heritage was African, as was Black women's. Hagar was a slave. Black American women had emerged from a slave heritage and still lived in light of it. Hagar was brutalized by her slave owner, the Hebrew woman Sarah. The slave narratives of African American women and some of the narratives of contemporary day workers tell of the brutal or cruel treatment Black women have received from the wives of slave masters and from contemporary white female employers. Hagar had no control over her body. It belonged to her slave owner, whose husband, Abraham, ravished Hagar. A child, Ishmael, was born. Mother and child were eventually cast out of Abraham's and Sarah's home without resources for survival. The bodies of African American slave women were owned by their masters. Time after time, they were raped by their owners and bore children whom the masters seldom claimed, children who were slaves, children and their mothers whom slave master fathers often cast out by selling them to other slaveholders. Hagar resisted the brutalities of slavery by running away. Black American women have a long resistance history that includes running away from slavery in the antebellum era. Like Hagar and her child Ishmael, African American female slaves and their children after slavery were expelled from the homes of many slaveholders and given no resources for survival. Hagar, like many women throughout African American women's history, was a single parent. But she had serious personal and salvific encounters with God, encounters which aided Hagar in the survival struggle of herself and her son. Over and over again, Black women in the churches have testified about their serious personal and salvific encounters with God, encounters that helped them and their families survive. I realized I had stumbled upon the beginning of an answer to my question. Where was I to begin in my effort to construct theology from the point of view of Black women's experience? I was to begin with the Black community, composed of females and males, and its understanding of God's historic relation to Black female life. And inasmuch as Hagar's story had been appropriated so extensively and for such a long time by the African American community, I reasoned that her story must be the community's analog for African American women's historic experience. My reasoning was supported, I thought, by the striking similarities between Hagar's story and African American women's history in North America. But what would I name this Hagar-centered tradition of African American biblical appropriation? I did not feel that it belonged to the liberation tradition of African American biblical appropriation. My exposure to feminist studies had convinced me that women must claim their experience, which has for so long been submerged by the overlay of oppressive, patriarchal cultural forms. And one way to claim experience is to name it. Naming also establishes some permanence and visibility for women's experience in history. At this point, my effort to name the women-centered tradition was facilitated by the work of anthropologist Lawrence Levine. He concluded that African Americans, especially during slavery, did not accommodate themselves to the Bible. Rather, they accommodated the Bible to the urgent necessities of their lives. But in this business of accommodating the Bible to life, I knew that the Black American religious community had not traditionally put final emphasis upon the hopelessness of the painful aspects of Black history, whether paralleled in the Bible or not. Rather, Black people used the Bible to put primary emphasis upon God's response to the community's situations of pain and bondage. So I asked myself, what was God's response to Hagar's predicament? Were her pain and God's response to it congruent with African American women's predicament and their understanding of God's response to Black women's suffering? Perhaps by answering these questions, I could arrive at a name for this Hagar-centered tradition of African American biblical appropriation. A very superficial reading of Genesis chapter 16, verses 1 through 16, and chapter 21, verses 9 through 21, in the Hebrew Testament, revealed that Hagar's predicament involved slavery, poverty, ethnicity, sexual and economic exploitation, surrogacy, rape, domestic violence, homelessness, motherhood, single parenting, and radical encounters with God. Another aspect of Hagar's predicament was made clear in the Christian Testament when Paul, Galatians chapter 4, verses 21 through chapter 5, verse 1, relegated her and her progeny to a position outside of and antagonistic to the great promise Paul says Christ brought to mankind. Thus, in Paul's text, Hagar bears only negative relation to the new creation Christ represents. In the Christian context of Paul, then, Hagar and her descendants represent the outsider position par excellence. So alienation is also part of the predicament of Hagar and her progeny. God's response to Hagar's story in the Hebrew Testament is not liberation. Rather, God participates in Hagar's and her child's survival on two occasions. When she was a runaway slave, God met her in the wilderness and told her to resubmit herself to her oppressor, Sarah, that is, to return to bondage. Latin American biblical scholar Elsa Tamez may be correct when she interprets God's action here to be on behalf of the survival of Hagar and child. Hagar could not give birth in the wilderness. Perhaps neither she nor the child could survive such an ordeal. Perhaps the best resources for assuring the life of mother and child were in the home of Abraham and Sarah. Then, when Hagar and her child were finally cast out of the home of their oppressors and were not given proper resources for survival, God provided Hagar with a resource. God gave her new vision to see survival resources where she had seen none before. Liberation in the Hagar stories is not given by God. It finds its source in human initiative. Finally, in Hagar's story, there is the suggestion that God will be instrumental in the development of Ishmael's and Hagar's quality of life, for God was with the boy. He grew up and made his home in the desert, wilderness, and he became an archer. Genesis chapter 21, verse 20. Thus, it seemed to me that God's response to Hagar's and her child's situation was survival and involvement in their development of an appropriate quality of life that is appropriate to their situation and their heritage. Because they would finally live in the wilderness without the protection of a larger social unit, it was perhaps to their advantage that Ishmael be skillful with the bow. He could protect himself and his mother. The fact that Hagar took a wife for Ishmael from the land of Egypt suggests that Hagar wanted to perpetuate her own cultural heritage, which was Egyptian, and not that of her oppressors, Abraham and Sarah. Even today, most of Hagar's situation is congruent with many African-American women's predicament of poverty, sexual and economic exploitation, surrogacy, domestic violence, homelessness, rape, motherhood, single parenting, ethnicity, and meetings with God. Many Black women have testified that God helped them make a way out of no way. They believe God is involved not only in their survival struggle, but that God also supports their struggle for quality of life, which making a way suggests. I concluded then that the female-centered tradition of African-American biblical appropriation could be named the survival-slash-quality-of-life tradition of African-American biblical appropriation. This naming was consistent with the Black American community's way of appropriating the Bible, so that emphasis is put upon God's response to Black people's situation, rather than upon what would appear to be hopeless aspects of African-American people's existence in North America. In Black consciousness, God's response of survival and quality of life to Hagar is God's response of survival and quality of life to African-American women and mothers of slave descent struggling to sustain their families with God's help. Several Black scholars have suggested a bond in Black American heritage between the survival-slash-quality-of-life struggle and the community's belief in God's presence in the struggle. Historian John Blassingame points to this reality in the slave community when he claims that one of the primary reasons the slaves were able to survive the cruelty they faced was that their behavior was not totally dependent on their masters. In religion, a slave exercised his own independence of conscience. Convinced that God watches over him, the slave bore his, and her, earthly afflictions, in order to earn a heavenly reward. Often he disobeyed his earthly master's rules to keep his heavenly master's commandments. Religious faith gave an ultimate purpose to his life, a sense of communal fellowship and personal worth. In short, religion helped him preserve his mental health. Trust in God was conducive to psychic health insofar as it excluded all anxiety-producing preoccupations by the recognition of a loving providence. Church historian Gyro S. Wilmore, in his discussion of the slave's survival efforts, also suggests the inextricable relation between survival slash quality of life and the slave's religious faith, which of course presupposed God's presence in the struggle. If whites thought they were dealing with children who could not discern the difference between white theology and white behavior, they were sadly mistaken. As John Lovell Jr. has observed, the slave relied upon religion, not primarily because he felt himself converted, but because he recognized the power inherent in religious things. That power had to do, first of all, with the necessity of survival, with the creation of an alternative reality system that could keep the slave alive and possessed of some modicum of sanity. The protest and resistance elements we find in early forms of Black folk religions in the Caribbean and in the southeastern United States express the determination to survive against all odds. The slave's effort to create an alternative value system represents a struggle to achieve a positive quality of life. With their syncretized African-American religion, syncretized by elements of African traditional religions, they believed in God's presence with them. This belief, connecting with the survival slash quality of life struggle, gave hope to slaves' daily lives of oppression and toil. Affirming the similarities between Hagar's predicament and African-American women's historic predicament, as well as affirming the congruence of the two understandings of God's response to these situations, the survival-slash-quality-of-life tradition of African-American biblical appropriation showed me more clearly what was involved in constructing womanist God talk. The first step was to provide Black people with a deeper understanding of Hagar's story than the account in the Hebrew Testament. This meant exploring social and cultural realities relevant to the biblical account. Thus, Chapter 1 of Sisters in the Wilderness, entitled Hagar's Story, A Route to Black Women's Issues, rereads Hagar's story in the Hebrew Testament, taking seriously some of the Hebraic, Egyptian, and nomadic social and cultural forces that could have had an impact upon Hagar's situation. My rereading is a method of biblical interpretation shaped by the Latin American feminist way of viewing Hagar's story from the perspective of poor, oppressed women. What this means is attempting to see the Hagar-Sarah texts in the Bible from the position of the slave woman Hagar rather than from the perspective of slave owners, Abraham and Sarah, and their culture. For the purposes of Sisters in the Wilderness, this method is suitable because the African-American community in North America has already appropriated the story with Hagar as the central human figure rather than Sarah or Abraham. Rereading does not mean changing the text as it appears in the Bible or adding characters to the Hagar-Sarah stories that do not appear in the biblical accounts. Within the context of African-American interpretation, reading can mean bringing in more non-traditional sources to aid in the interpretation than have been used by such leading Western exegetes as Gerhard von Rad, E. A. Spicer, Klaus Westermann, Phyllis Tribble, Elsa Tamez, and others. For instance, the re-reader conscious of the African-American tradition of appropriating Hagar in her story and trying to see the story from Hagar's position might be interested in enlarging interpretation by focusing on some aspects of African, Egyptian culture that might have affected Hagar's behavior on some occasions. Some Egyptian customs that might have affected Hagar are described in chapter 1. This attention to African heritage relative to Hagar's story resonates with African-American Christians' long attempt to uncover African residuals in their culture and religious experience, and to discover, as much as possible, about Africa's relation to the Bible. The attention to Hagar's African heritage also conforms to recent efforts of Black biblical scholars to ferret out the African references in Scripture that Western biblical scholarship has heretofore ignored and thus made invisible. From this rereading of Hagar's story comes the second step involved in providing God talk mindful of Black women's experience. Heuristics and issues emerge that are used in subsequent chapters in Sisters in the Wilderness to explore the nature of African American women's experience in both the Black and white American worlds. Though most of the issues in the Hagar story could be used to lay fully open the many dimensions of Black women's experience, space limitations allowed only a few to be used. Therefore, I selected from Hagar's story those issues that had simultaneously personal, social, and religious significance for Black women and for the African American community. The predicament of motherhood, the character of surrogacy, the problem of ethnicity, and the meaning and significance of wilderness experience for women and for the community. Hence, chapter 2 in this book, Tensions in Motherhood from Slavery to Freedom, explores what appears to be evolving tensions in African-American understandings of the function of Black motherhood. Chapter 3, entitled Social Role Surrogacy, Naming Black Women's Oppression, explores the nature of Black women's experience with surrogacy in both antebellum and postbellum America. Chapter 4 approaches the subject of ethnicity from the perspective of skin color, the badge of African-American ethnicity in North America. Rather than probe the character of racism with regard to Black women's experience, this chapter shows how skin color consciousness and the value put upon color have birthed a pathological pattern in American culture that continues to this day. This pattern is named white racial narcissism. However, the aim of the chapter is not to be accusatory. Rather, its aim is to show a method by which the devaluation and abuse of Black people, both female and male, through the centuries, has been gradually cemented into America's national consciousness. Chapter 5, Sisters in the Wilderness and Community Meanings, draws brief analogies between Hagar's experience in the wilderness and African American women's understanding of their wilderness experience. Then the chapter shows how Black women's experience and the Black community's experience come together in a symbolic sense attached to the African-American notion of wilderness. A discussion of the intellectual, social, and political significance of this Black wilderness symbolism ends the chapter. Part 2 of Sisters in the Wilderness, Womanist God Talk, begins with Chapter 6, Womanist God Talk and Black Liberation Theology. This chapter discusses certain classical texts in Black liberation theology. James Cone, A Black Theology of Liberation, 2nd edition. James Cone, God of the Oppressed. James Diotis Roberts, Liberation and Reconciliation, A Black Theology. And Cecil Wayne Cone, The Identity Crisis in Black Theology. Based on insights from the explorations in earlier chapters, the Womanist God Talk in Chapter 6 dialogues with Black liberation theology in the areas of theological methodology, doctrine, and ethics. The dialogue is focused in each area by specific issues. In the area of method in liberation theology, the focus is upon the use of the Bible, the understanding and function of experience, and the notion of the theological task. In the area of doctrine, the Womanist God Talk attempts more to enlighten than to dialogue. That is, it reveals the questions about the doctrine of atonement that arise when African American women's surrogacy experience is reflected upon. The Womanist God Talk on this subject invites Black liberation theologians into conversation with women about atonement, since Black liberation theology has not, to date, given consideration to the meaning of atonement in its enterprise. In the area of ethics, the womanist discussion in this chapter uncovers an ethical task Black theologians, female and male, exercise in their work. Chapter 7, Womanist-Feminist Dialogue, Differences and Commonalities, enters into dialogue with a variety of feminist voices, African, Asian, White American, Hispanic, and other womanist. The first part of this chapter focuses on the theological differences between some feminist/womanist texts and the content of Sisters in the Wilderness on such issues as the meaning and use of such terms as virginity, as in the Virgin Mary, the understanding in different cultures of what is acceptably female, and other issues. The last part of the chapter indicates some of the common ground upon which womanists and feminists stand theologically. Some feminist theological positions, very much relevant for the womanist God talk in Sisters in the Wilderness, are not included. This is because these positions need more conversation with my position than this present book can provide. For instance, theologian Carter Hayward's position on mutual relation and writing relationships has affinity with my position. At some point, we and other feminists who hold this position need to discuss the differences we each espouse on these issues. But we need a full text to do this. Obviously, Beverly Harrison's work and other work in women's reproduction rights and in reproduction technology have a lot to say to my womanist suggestion that Black women's history be understood as reproduction history, that is, reproduction history that uses labor as a hermeneutic to interpret Black women's biological and social experience of reproducing and nurturing the species, and labor as an interpretive tool for analyzing and assessing Black women's creative productions, as well as their relation to power structures in both the Black and white worlds. Certainly, I need to give this more thought. This observation about Black women's history as reproduction history, like some of the other ideas in the book, is suggestive. Though relevant to the content of Sisters in the Wilderness, some of these suggestive ideas will be developed more fully in another context. They are mentioned in this text because I think we womanist theologians must get as many ideas out there as possible when we have the chance, that is, ideas relevant to whatever subject we are treating at the time. Most of us know racism and sexism in the publishing business and in theological education lets only a few Black people, female and male, into positions that allow us to have a public voice and to publish. Therefore, we must share as much with each other as we can so that many, many ideas relevant to our people can get abroad, even if the ideas are developed later by someone other than the original contributor. The last chapter in Sisters in the Wilderness is entitled Womanist Reflections on the Black Church, the African-American Denominational Churches, and the Universal Hagar's Spiritual Church. This chapter begins with my faith statement celebrating the idea of the Black Church. I make a distinction between the Black Church and the African-American denominational churches. Then I catalog some sins against Black women practiced in some of the African-American denominational churches. I also introduce the Universal Hagar's spiritual churches, which bear the name of Hagar in the Bible. Most of my knowledge of the Hagar churches has come from personal visits, conversations, and from the work of Hans Baer, who has produced the only extended study of the Universal Hagar's spiritual churches that I could find. No scholar has focused extensively upon women in the Hagar's churches. Chapter 8 is called Reflections rather than something more academic because it presents the awful side of the African American denominational churches that has not to date been documented and has never been included in the scholarly treatments of these churches. The awful side is Black women's experience of sexist oppression at the major leadership and other levels of church life. The word reflection in the title allows me to reference the accusations and evaluations of the African-American churches made to me in conversation with other Black women struggling amid this sexist oppression to honor their ministerial call from God. One last word must be said about womanist God talk in general. As Black women retrieving our experience from invisibility, each of us retrieves from the underside of the underside partial facts about ourselves and partial visions of missing parts of our experience. So in theology, our womanist work together is to connect these pieces of fact and vision. Like a mosaic, these colored pieces will eventually make many designs of Black women's experience. These designs, as well as the pieces that compose them, will be available to serve as pieces for future generations of Black women seeking to understand and describe Black women's experience anew in light of the relation between the past and changing times. Hence, the method in womanist theological books often attempts first to provide pieces of fact and pieces of vision subjected to the critical reflection of the particular theologian. The second step is the constructive one. Sisters in the Wilderness is representative of that first step. Another book will have to contain my second, constructive step. Many womanists perhaps agree with Mary Daly that an over-concern for method in theology has got something to do with patriarchy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.